So on one side of the street, you have nice, new, gentrified apartment complexes, houses. You see some cars on the street. And right there, you got one of the many encampments in Seattle.
Since then, you've seen a dramatic increase in inequality. Obviously, it's economic inequality, but it's disproportionately falling on the shoulders of people of color, the black and brown communities. And we are here, we had this affordable housing meeting of my committee in a church in the Central District. And so black communities built their lives here, working class black people built their lives here. But now this entire city is becoming hostage to developer profits and greed.
We're one of the communities with the fastest rising rents of any community across the country. And other communities in similar positions with very rapidly rising rents are seeing this crisis of affordable housing and the lack of affordable housing. So that has put pressure on the market in a way that folks that are living on the margin, living paycheck to paycheck, can no longer afford the housing that they're in. We have half the units available in the community that we once did to people with the lowest incomes.
Right, yeah, no, a lot of us are willing to work. I mean, I myself, there's a gentleman two blocks over, and I've done his brakes on his van. I've changed his oil. I tuned up his van and changed all the spark plugs on it for him. My buddy's actually a mechanic too, and like we do odd jobs for people in the neighborhood. I mean, if we can find them that are willing to deal with us, you know. So it's not that we don't want to work. One of the factors is I don't want to go out and look for a job and then, you know, come back and realize that, hey, in a half hour I had to have all my stuff and be gone again, you know.
About 40% of those that respond to that survey are currently working. They're just working in jobs that do not pay at the level that will allow them to afford rent in this region, afford housing in this region generally. And there's families experiencing homelessness, veterans experiencing homelessness, and that there is not one image or face that describes this crisis.
The homeless population has probably increased by at least triple fold, maybe four times. There are now more than 4,000 homeless kids in the Seattle School District. So that's like 8% of all children are homeless in the Seattle School.
I think the most important thing to recognize is that we have a shortage of resources. In one given night when we do the annual point in time count, we've estimated that about 12,000 people are experiencing homelessness just on one given night, sheltered and unsheltered. But over the course of a year, three times that many individuals are falling into homelessness. And we do not have the resources to support people in connecting with permanent housing quickly at that scale and at that rate. So I think the most important piece about the debate about the head tax is embracing and understanding the fact that this is not just a Seattle crisis, this is a regional crisis, and one that we do need resources to address.
But they're not addressing the elephant in the room. They're still taking corporate money. They're still doubling down on profiting from prisons. You know, Seattle's still building a $500,000 more now youth jail that we've been battling for over 4 years.
So instead of building a $500,000 affordable housing
complex. Exactly, we still want to cage kids. We don't want to think about alternative solutions. We're still building it where? In the Central District, where the black population went from 60% to single digits. And we're building that.
So many people that are coming straight out of evictions are ending up right on the street and then finding themselves in cycles of chronic homelessness. So when I say sweeps, I mean encampment removals. The city calls them encampment cleanups, as if it were just a bunch of garbage that needed to be swept along. I prefer evictions myself, because that's really, it's really what it is. I had a bout with living in my car in and out for about 2 years right out of college, and I did sometimes have housing, but I was evicted twice in that period. And when I see the city's notice come up for these encampment removals, I really see it kind of the way I felt in those times that I was evicted.
Seattle and cities like it are, I think, in many corporate areas, think it's booming, but it doesn't seem to be booming for anyone but the wealthy.
Right, and I think everything you captured in that comment and question really is goes to the heart of the way the capital system works, which is that you can have a booming economy and yet that booming economy is going to leave behind the vast majority of people to some measure or another, some worse than the others.
And it's because everyone has this consensus now, is like, to protect wealth or to redistribute wealth, you need to do it hyperlocally. That's where you protect your taxes. That's where, you know, you protect policies where you prevent rezoning of neighborhoods. And that's where you really, if you don't control the city council in your neighborhoods, you're gonna have to find another place. And that's why Amazon was threatening, if Jenny Durkin, our current mayor, who received hundreds of thousands of dollars from Amazon and corporations like that, didn't win, they were threatening to leave. Mm-hmm. They're threatening to leave Seattle if the head tax was passed and city council, again, a battle of principle, and if 5 of the 9 city council members decided to vote for the head tax, it wouldn't have made a huge dent on Amazon or the homelessness crisis, but it would have shown Amazon this city council is not on our side anymore. And we're moving forward if we want to protect as much of our wealth as possible. Mm. And the city council folded.
Is sort of the narrative is that if you have a rich person who gives a little bit of money to philanthropy, whatever that is, then they're seen as a good person, right? Mm-hmm. But in fact, that's just patina for enabling them to get more and more money. Mm-hmm. And you have to ask, well, where does that money come from? It's not self-made money. If you buy an Amazon product, well, then you're buying a product that is, first of all, made by people all over the world, right? And secondly, Amazon is basically the collector distributor, so they're just taking something as the middleman in between.
I mean, they got 12 freaking Google buildings down on the waterfront, you know what I mean? And you see a couple tents pitched out there even, you know? But, I don't know, it's nuts, because, I mean, you see so much stuff out here, and it's just surprising to me that they don't have something, like they have a couple little tiny house areas, you know what I mean? I'm surprised they don't have a certain area that, you know what I mean, they couldn't tell us that we could stay in and kind of police ourselves or whatever, you know what I mean? Because there's plenty of room out here, you know?
It's not just a class cleansing, it's a racial cleansing as well. In the homeless population here in Seattle, in the last count that came out, they do a one-night count in the winter every year. There were 29% of the homeless population were African-American people. Only 8% of the entire population of Seattle is African-American. Same thing with natives. We've got Alaska natives and indigenous people that are living here in Seattle. They make up less than 1% of the entire population of the city, and they make up about 7 or 8% of the homeless population. So, you know, we got to talk about this from not only a class lens, but as well from a race lens. And now if we are going to look at it from both of those lenses.
Jobs get created only as a means, only so far as they are a means for expanding, ever expanding the profits for a small section at the top. And who are we talking about? Our enemies are not the workers in the tech sector. Our enemies are Jeff Bezos, Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, billionaires like that. In fact, those three billionaires own more wealth than the entire bottom half of the US population. That's the kind of system we're talking about.
When you see Amazon donating hundreds of thousands of dollars to hyper-local campaigns, that's a clear sign that, I'll say this. I think one thing everyone has realized is the importance of hyperlocal elections.
Where are we gonna set up? Is the spot that we set up and gonna get, you know, are we gonna get told to leave in a half hour's notice like we did at Green Lake, or, you know, a week out from now, are they gonna come and, you know, sweep us again? And it's just a struggle because we don't know exactly where to go. If we knew where we could go and set up and have some ground rules established, you know what I mean, and some criteria to follow, then, you know, we'd like set a standard, then we could, you know, set that goal and, you know, try and maintain a little community there, but it's just a struggle.
My dad was recently diagnosed of stage 4 lung cancer. To make long story short, he was undergoing for chemotherapy all the time. My mom, she just had this surgery. they depend on me. If Cadence is going to move us out, I don't know where I'm going to live.
Hope you enjoyed that last video. Hop on over to statuscoup.com where you can sign up for our email list and become a member for as low as $5 to $10 a month. Membership is how we grow. That's statuscoup.com/join. And remember, join our email list so we can grow the revolution with you.